So I just want to give you just a brief intro to sort of put a story behind the project that we created. So we were having issues in the study with recruitment. It had started up recruitment in spring of 2020, which is not an ideal time to start up a study. And so it took us a little bit to realize that there were some issues with the study and with recruitment that were not COVID related. So there was sort of a delay there. So I sort of came on to manage the study sort of in the middle of it when they had realized there were recruitment issues and they were sort of starting back a little bit at square one with recruitment. And so about halfway through, we made substantial changes to the study, which were IRB approved. And so it was kind of like study startup, except it wasn't, because we were in the middle of the study and time was ticking. So it was kind of like study startup, except that it wasn't, because we were in the middle of the study and we were already in a no-cost extension year. So we needed to really focus on recruitment, but then also we had made so many substantial changes to the study that we really needed a new REDCap database to sort of capture that. So it can often feel overwhelming when you're starting up a new study, especially if you're behind, because there's so many different things to focus on. So an important point I want to, you know, sort of call to your attention and bring up is, so why take the time to, you know, sort of look at and map out what the study process looks like? Why is that important? So something I've discovered is it can be difficult and if not impossible to go back and collect data that we missed. And this can be for a couple reasons. One is if you didn't correctly input all of the elements of the protocol, or two, if the workflow is difficult and it results in data being missing. It can be problematic too if you have like free text for numbers, like a one, and then they could write in the number one or like the word one, or they can spell it or capitalize it. So like on the back side, you have different categories for that one. And that's why I really think, you know, it's clear communication is important, especially if you have other study staff members that are on the study with you that you need to communicate this to. So you really want to be able to clearly articulate the needs of the study and communicate that to the interested stakeholders. And in order to do that, you really need to understand all of the elements of the protocol and even some outside elements. And you also want to be open-minded and listen to input of those stakeholders, because they can improve the process for you. And so workflow is something that I'm going to want to focus on here in the slides. So what are these elements of the protocol that can be important to focus on? You want to think about how data will be collected, what data is being collected, who's providing the data, who's collecting the data, and all of the regulatory aspects as well. So some examples of regulatory could include things like consent notes or eligibility verification. If you have IRB approval and you want to use paper, you might want to build in a paper CRF component so that any study staff could upload those source documents. Something that's, you know, I thought was, you know, really important too was, and I talked about this in the protocol part, but putting in the right measures. So for example, on the DECIDE study that I was on, we had changed some of the measures to sort of make the study easier for the participants to be able to complete. And so making sure that you have the most up-to-date and valid measures that are going in to make sure that you can collect the correct data is really important. So I wanted to focus on workflow a little bit, because what you're really doing here is taking kind of a one-dimensional protocol and you're making it into a 3D study. So you want to be able to consider what the study flow will look like. So for example, who on the study needs to collect the data, who can input the data, and what works best for them. So something that I wanted to bring up is that on the current study that I'm on, we have clinician providers who have to input data. They're our study staff. And we just sort of assumed, as people who use REDCap all the time and are very, you know, versatile in it, that they would just log in with their REDCap accounts and just input the data and it would be fine. And what we sort of discovered was we had a lot of missing data for those components that they had to input. And what we discovered was that these clinicians were really not using REDCap a lot. So this was something else that they were gonna have to create and learn. And they were just so busy that they just weren't doing it. So we sort of had to think of a way, it wasn't working into their workflow. And as a result, we were having a lot of data. And that's not gonna work. So that's something that maybe we could have done a better job incorporating them into and getting feedback on. And so what we did was we sort of troubleshooted, like, what's wrong here? What's the barrier, you know, keeping you from being able to input this data that we need? And so what we were able to do was be flexible with the database and turn the data points that they had to put in into surveys. So now we're just sending them an email, they're just completing it, and it's in the REDCap database. And that really solved that missing data problem. And really, if we would have done that on the front side, we wouldn't have had so much missing data to begin with. So it's, when you look at the protocol, it tells you what needs to be in the database, but some of these outside things like workflow and regulatory, it doesn't tell you how to do that. So that's something you sort of have to figure out with your team. So what I ended up doing was, once you understand the protocol and the workflow, you can create a diagram, and that's what I ended up doing to represent it. I tried to represent that 3D image of the in a diagram so that I could see how this was really going to work for the DECIDE study. I think you could also create a list. It just sort of depends on what kind of person you are. I'm both a diagram analyst person, but for this purpose, I thought the diagram worked really well. You can use any kind of diagramming software. I used Excel, but you could also use, I don't know if anyone's ever used Draw.io. It's like a web-based flow diagram. You could use that as well. It's really whatever you're most comfortable with. So what I did was I just created this in Excel. This is for the parents. This kind of lets you know, what happens in enrollment. I mean, I know this is kind of busy and because the study was kind of busy, but what I did was I sort of used different color codings to help me understand who's going to complete what and what, where in the process that happens. And then I was able to give myself sort of a diet, like need space on this. Need space on this form for a recording. So something that I really tried to do was keep everything that I needed for this study as much as possible in REDCap. When I had taken over from the coordinator before me, some of it was in the study file, some of it was in Word, some of it was in Excel. And what I've found from being audited in the past is having everything in sort of a central location is really helpful. So that's something that I tried to do here. And then what I did was I showed this to the PI and I said, is this your intention? Before I even created any REDCap, is this your intention? Is this right? And I'll tell you, the first iteration of this, I don't know if you can see, but where it says Kim KSR, 4 questions, not WAISR, we had changed some of the measures in the study, and I had the wrong measures in as the ones that, so if I hadn't ran this by her and just created the REDCap, I would have been wrong, which is a big deal, right? You don't want to collect the wrong data. So that's why I found this to be really useful. I also, you know, put in a gift card tracker so I could keep track of that when parents are off study, et cetera. And so this is kind of how it translated into a REDCap. I was lucky enough to be able to work with a data manager from Biostats on this. So not only did I have to understand the study, but I had to understand it well enough that I could explain to that person what the study needed in REDCap. And so together we sort of created this. This is a testing database. So it doesn't have any real data in it. And so then I did the same thing. So like I said, we had parents that needed to complete it, and then we also had providers. And so this one is a little bit more simple for the providers, but again, I diagrammed it to make sure that it was correct. And then I also color-coded who would be completing what and tried to create a workflow out of it. And then I showed it to the PI and some of the study staff to make sure, does this work? Is this what's intended? Am I on the right track? And then this translated into a simpler REDCap, but it also sort of helps you understand too where people are in the study, which I really like. And again, this is a testing phase. So once you've diagrammed it and then you've sort of created your REDCap, something I thought was really important is to test your understanding. So you want to create a training database like the one I showed you with, and then go ahead and test that database and put dummy data in it. I think it's important to have stakeholder involvement. So you'll want to involve the PI and any other study staff members that are going to have to be involved in this process. And you're going to want them to, you know, help test it for you, because they may need to use it, or they may have other ideas that maybe you hadn't thought of. So for example, you could put test data in there and then have the PI, you know, run a fake analysis on the data that you pull out, just to make sure that what you're getting is what they'll need in the end, because you can't know until you've, you know, kind of ran the whole thing. So it's important to have others test it to ensure accuracy, and then also solicit feedback. But then once you've thoroughly tested it, you can move your project to production status, which is always a happy feeling. After you've done all this work, you're like, yes, finally, we're getting there, right? So some lessons that I learned was to, you know, engage stakeholders early in the process, because if you don't, it can result in missing data, which is really, in my experience, can be hard to sort of get back. And to test out the project and have other stakeholders test it out as well, as much as they can. And then also leave room for flexibility in the design of the project. So even when we were thinking about designing this project for the DECIDE study, I was like, oh, you know, it's only gonna be study staff that's inputting this data. We don't need to make these into surveys, right? Because the study staff can just fill in. But in my earlier example, you can see that sometimes the study staff may not be as familiar with REDCap, or maybe it's not part of their, especially clinicians, it's not part of their primary job to get into that. So it might, you might want to leave some flexibility in there for things that you may not anticipate once you're actually, once the study actually is done. So as far as feedback on this process, we did have a postdoc student. We were lucky enough to have a postdoc student on this study. And she gave me really positive feedback on this, something I think in research that you may not always understand is that other people's understanding of the study, and we had done so many changes to it. What she said after I showed that diagram was, this is the first time I've really understood like this whole process and this whole workflow. And she had been doing this longer than I had. So I thought, wow, you know, that's a really powerful statement. Sometimes people are, I think, afraid to speak up in a group and say, I don't really understand that, or people feel like they're supposed to understand it and they don't. But it's important that everybody understands it. And I felt like that visual really helped spell it out, right? What should be happening at each time. And like I said, even I had the wrong measures in at the wrong time because of the switching out. And just to make sure everyone's on the same page. And especially if you're trying to explain it to someone else that has to create the REDCap, like a data manager or someone like that, you want to make sure you can clearly articulate, even if you understand. And I found that the diagram was really helpful in that regard. So I'd just like to do a couple quick acknowledgments to Dr. Roche. She was the PI on this study, and she encouraged me to do this presentation because she thought it was really helpful, which I, you know, really appreciated, and the NIH for funding the study. And so something that I like to do when I do a presentation is I feel like there's a lot of resources in the room. And so I like to tap into that. And so I wondered if you guys have any. I don't know, the bullets aren't showing up, but that's okay, I can read it. So I just wanted to brainstorm and just ask, like, so I've done mostly social behavioral studies, but what I think is great about REDCap is that you can tailor it to whatever your study is, right? So like maybe you guys are using it in a way that like I never thought of. So I thought it'd be interesting to just talk about if there's any visuals that you've ever used to help you understand or communicate requirements, and if you could talk a little bit about what they are. Does anyone have anything? To try to communicate what was needed? Or is there anything that you've learned today that you could use going forward or that you think is really interesting or useful on the different projects that you work on? Yeah, go ahead. Hold on 1 second. Let me there's a technology. Okay, now they can hear you, the people on. Okay. Sorry, I'm not a technology person. I think that's really great. I'm the same way. Like, I really feel like I really needed to see it. You can see in the protocol, but it's written in a scientific way and in its own order. And I wanted to know I know what's in there. How does this affect me? And then some of it that's sort of on the periphery of the protocol, like the consent or the consent notes or the gift card tracking, like none of that is in the protocol. So to try to keep it all together in like a streamlined process, I felt like the diagram was just really helpful. Does anyone have go ahead. Yes. Yes. Yeah. I think that's great because I don't do drug or device, and I was hoping someone who did would speak up and tell me how you could use this, because I thought this would be, you know, generalizable to whatever kind of study that you're doing before you put it into REDCap, so you can kind of articulate what's needed. I really liked the check there, because I'm kind of saying this is what I envision the study is going to be like. Do you agree? Is this right? Go ahead. I didn't put in, but you could. So like, I didn't put those in there. Those I will admit, as someone who just said, you should keep everything in there. Yeah, I kept those in my study file in like a OneDrive folder. But you absolutely could do that. Like you could just, and that's why I had put, this one's more complex. You can see where it says like need space on this form for recording. So I wanted to keep the recordings there. You could put, you know, need space on this form to keep communication and be able to upload that into your REDCap database. I think that's really smart, actually. That's why I like to do this, because I knew you guys would think of other ways of how to use this than I did. And so I think that's a really good point. Does anyone have anything else or any questions? Yeah. Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. If you have any questions, you can feel free to email me. I appreciate your time and listening today.